Lee's story is totally modern. It's about a I can't give away too much. It's called the Boneheaded League. And it's a story about a police investigator who gets sucked into a mystery that seems to resemble the events of the Redheaded League. He's a great Sherlock Holmes fan, and he recognizes that what's going on seems to mirror the events of that case. I can't say any more without spoiling it.
With Gail Lynn's and John Sheldon's...
Her husband, John Sheldon, now husband.
Now husband, because she moved from Santa Barbara all the way over to Maine to be, which is really a love story. But she had written quite a few things about the CIA and about international.
Best known as a thriller writer, but she's a closet Sherlock Holmes fan. She wrote a story with John about a judge, a contemporary story about a judge who solves a murder, who's a great fan of Holmes and uses his techniques.
And who has a young assistant, Artie. And it's written in the first person from Artie's point of view.
Artie Morey, wonderful name.
Yeah.
There's a lot of puns in the story if you are a Sherlock Holmes fan.
Yeah.
There's so many great stories. There's a story by Phil Margolin, who writes brilliant trial lawyer mysteries, and his brother Jerry. Jerry is a member of the Baker Street Irregulars. It's a locked room mystery about the murder of the world's greatest collector of Sherlock Holmes art. Well, Jerry Margolin happens to be the world's greatest collector of Sherlock Holmes art, so this is his own murder that he's writing about.
I think I'd be a little nervous about it if I were doing that.
Yes.
But again, let's go back to the Gail's story.
Yes.
Because it was the judge who, from his Artie is working for, and somebody has been killed, they think she has killed herself, and trying to figure out all of how it worked and the fact that a judge would have to turn in another judge.
Yes, it's a sad story. It's actually a story in which the detective is very sorry to dig up the truth.
Yeah.
The moral of the story is that it's not always a good thing to find out the truth. Sometimes one should just let sleeping dogs lie, I guess. There's a terrific story in the collection by Laura Lippman. Laura, we asked her to write the story for us, and then she said, look, I really want to do it, but I'm having a baby. I don't think I have time. And then the stories were supposed to be in by March. In January, she said, you know, this baby thing is working out a little easier than I thought. Can I still write a story for you? And we said, can you?
Yeah.
So she wrote a great story. It's about a 10-year-old girl who has some thoughts about Sherlock Holmes and mysteries and detecting and all that. It's a very moving story. It's not a traditional mystery story at all.
Yeah.
And it's certainly not a Sherlock Holmes story. It is just what we asked for, a story inspired by the Sherlock Holmes canon.
Yeah. Any of them that you turn back?
Not a one. Everyone was a gem. Every story that came in, we were just blown away. There's a reason that these are the major writers that they are. When we went to Random House with the idea for the book, and we showed them the list of people who had agreed to write stories for us, they just fell out of their chairs. They said, how did you get these people to do this? Lori likes to say, we know where the skeletons in the closets are. But they're all friends, and they all were thrilled to do this. And I think part of it for them was a chance to stretch, a chance to do something completely different from what they were known for. Lee Child, for example, who's probably the most successful thriller writer in the world, Jack Reacher, some of us noticed over the years, seems to quote Sherlock Holmes from time to time.
Yeah.
And I got into a long conversation with Lee. He knows tons about Sherlock Holmes. He doesn't let that on. He doesn't let people know.
All right, Leslie, you did not write a short story.
I didn't, and neither did Lori, and we don't want people to be disappointed. I have written one short story in my entire life. It was published. I think it was pretty good, but I think I got it out of my system. I'm not a fiction writer. I'm much more comfortable with writing footnotes.
Being the collector.
The collector, the annotator, the scholar, the editor.
Yeah.
That brings me great joy, and I really appreciate the talent behind these stories.
All right, next edition.
Random House was so happy with the results here. I mean, the sales have been terrific. We're very pleased with that. We went to Random House and we said, please, let us do a second volume. And they said, okay. Yeah. Michael Conley, Sarah Paretsky, Cornelia Funke, I'm going to leave people out. They're not all signed up yet. Lisa Lutz, Denise Hamilton, Megan Abbott. We're going to have, I should mention, this collection has a graphic story by the wonderful mystery writer Colin Cotterill, who's an Englishman who lives in Thailand. It's 10 or 12 pages long. It's like a comic book. That was so much fun that we deliberately went out and got another graphic writer, John Repian and Leah Moore. Leah Moore is the daughter of Alan Moore. They have written several Sherlock Holmes-related comic books and Dracula-related comics in the past, and they're going to do a story for us.
I read it, and I kept saying, I would love to see this on stage, because there are certain of the stories that lends itself to theater.
It would be lovely to see these stories have lives of their own. They're all maybe a television series.
Yeah.
We can have it be an anthology series. Anthologies, you know, as we were talking, are kind of a dying breed.
Yeah.
We were
Rod
so thrilled.
Serling. I mean.
Yes, we were so thrilled to be able to put together an anthology that people are excited about.
Yeah. So. I'm just trying to remember. The last story in the book is.
I don't remember which last one is in order.
The case that Holmes the imitator, and the last, yeah.
There's a great story by Jan Burke.
Jan's
story, interestingly, there's a character in it who dresses and acts like Sherlock Holmes, but he's not the detective. He's not the one who comes up with the solution of the mystery. It's set in the 1920s. There's also a great story by Jackie Winspear, which I dare not tell you the ending. It's about a young boy who is a great fan of the Sherlock Holmes stories and tries to solve a mystery surrounding his own life.
Yeah.
It's got a wonderful twist ending.
She's interesting, too. I talked to her in the first book about Daisy.
About Maisie Dobbs, yes.
Yeah, Maisie, rather. And I just thought, this is something unique.
Jackie writes a wonderful series about a nurse, retired nurse, who basically it's the post World War I era in England, and the story she wrote is set squarely in that era, and it's just delicious. Such a great surprise ending.
Yeah. Question about the era of Holmes and what was going on in the world at that time. Was this something that a man like Holmes, even today, if we could have someone who seems to be intelligent?
I think that Holmes would do very well today. The BBC television series that I loved, called Sherlock, that was on last year and will be on again in the spring here on PBS, shows a modern Sherlock Holmes. He's manic. He's a bit of a sociopath. He's a, quote, consultant to the police. He texts. He uses his cell phone. He has his own website and all that. Yeah. I think Holmes would be a highly functioning person in our modern age. He would adapt himself immediately to all of this information that's out there and be the master of it.
Mycroft never knew he had a brother.
Right, a great character, Mycroft. He only appears in three stories, and a very popular character because he's in some ways just like Holmes. He has the same brilliant mind, the same ability to deduce, but he's completely lazy. He's much more like I would be, I think. He likes to sit in an armchair and reason things out. He can't be induced to get up out of his chair and go figure things out himself. He'll let somebody else do the spade work.
I would say the great inheritor also of Holmes, George Bernard Shaw, for Pygmalion, for Henry Higgins.
Absolutely. There's no question about it that Shaw modeled Higgins and Colonel Pickering, on Holmes and Watson. There are several scenes that are lifted straight out of the Conan Doyle stories. And by the way, I mean, Shaw was a friend of Conan Doyle's. They knew each other quite well. And the stories, we've kind of forgotten that These stories, the Sherlock Holmes stories, were immensely popular. There is no comparison today to the level of popularity that they had in their day. Mm-hmm. It was an era when nobody was, books weren't competing with television or radio. So books were the name of the game. And the Strand magazine built its fortune on the Sherlock Holmes stories.
Deservedly so. And I thank you, Leslie. Will you
Always
autograph
a pleasure.
My
I'd
book?
I'd be delighted.
And if you'd like to know what else we've been reading, visit me on the web at www.conniemartinson.com. Speaking of George Bernard Shaw, there is a terrific new nonfiction book by Jay Tunney about his father, Jack Dempsey, who, not Jack Dempsey, his father was Gene Tunney, who beat Jack Dempsey in the long count. Jay's father became a good friend of George Bernard Shaw. It was interesting. Gene Tunney was a poor Irish boy who really made a fortune by being a prize fighter, but he really preferred knowing writers. He loved writers, and when he went to England, somebody said, "You've got to meet George Bernard Shaw." Well, hello, that's the best thing anyone could have said to him. He marries a very well-to-do young lady. He stops being a boxer. On his honeymoon, they invite George Bernard Shaw to the island in Italy where they are vacationing. And they begin such a great friendship, walking and talking. And even when Tunney's wife becomes ill, instead of leaving, George Bernard Shaw and his wife Charlotte stay to help get her better because she had almost died. Well, it's a great story of friendships between generations, because here is Gene Tunney, he is in his 30s, and there's George Bernard Shaw in his late 70s. Beautiful. Meanwhile, support your library, go in, read some of the, if you have not read the original Sherlock Holmes, you are in for a treat. I have to confess, I had not till I met Leslie and read the annotated, and I couldn't believe, how could this great writing be there? Well, I too had my eyes open, and I love Sherlock Holmes. You will too, and so will your children. And we'll see you next time. Thank you so much.
My pleasure, Connie.
Thank you.